All right, we're starting or finishing part three of chapter six. So we're going to look at something called the Fick equation. So we see here a large definition, but let's break apart each of those highlighted variables. So first we want to understand what VO2 is, which I'm sure we already do. Volume of oxygen consumed. So basically how much oxygen the body is using. When we say VO2 max, it's how much oxygen the body is using during exercise. And so we read substance removed from the blood passing through an organ per unit of time. That substance is oxygen, being removed from the blood that's passing over, and we'll say an organ, so a working muscle. So how do we calculate that? By multiplying the blood flow through an organ, which we know is cardiac output, because cardiac output is the amount of blood pumped per minute. Times the arterial concentration minus the venous concentration of that substance, which that substance is oxygen, and we learned VO2 difference in the last video. So I know that's a lot, but we can look at it here and explain these variables a little bit more. So we already said VO2, the amount of oxygen that we're consuming, but we're mainly concerned with how much oxygen is being delivered to the working muscle. So that's what we're trying to figure out. How do we figure that out? We first have to know how much blood flow is actually arriving at that muscle, so passing through the capillary bed in a given tissue. And we know that as cardiac output. An AVO2 difference, we already described as the amount of blood or the amount of oxygen in arterial blood entering a muscle minus the amount of oxygen in the venous blood leaving the muscle. So we will have to know that difference in milliliters, so looking at oxygen. So we have our equation there, but what you kind of want to understand is the Fick equation basically just determines oxygen consumption for the entire body. The Fick equation shows that either increasing cardiac output or VO2 difference can increase VO2. And this basically just shows there's an increase in oxygen delivery for the entire body. And more blood pumped per minute or more oxygen delivered to the muscle can also increase VO2 during exercise. VO2 will determine total oxygen delivery. And that's what's basically shown here. So an increase in both blood flow and VO2 difference occurs during exercise. And the reason it occurs is because we have to increase the volume of oxygen that we're actually consuming from rest to max values. So when we're at a rested state, our VO2 is very low. We're not consuming a huge volume of air in general, which means we're not consuming a large volume of oxygen. But let's give some variables, such as during exercise. What do those numbers look like? So a average person, so untrained average person, their VO2 max may be 30 to 40. And what that's measured in is milliliters per kilogram per minute, and that's talking about volume of oxygen. A trained person may have a 40 to 50 milliliters per kilogram per minute VO2. And then elite, that number is about 50 to 60. It just means more oxygen is being consumed by the body and being delivered to the working muscle. So let's continue with our Fick equation, and we're going to break it down even further. So we see our Fick equation at the top. Again, just remember that VO2 is representing total oxygen delivery to the body. So we have Q, which we know Q is a product of heart rate times stroke volume, and then AVO2 difference. So this A here is referring to arterial blood, we're looking at the oxygen content, minus the venous blood, looking at that oxygen content. So normally we would have a kind of a partner discussion and during class where you and your little group or partner would answer these questions. So what I want you to do on your own while watching this video is pause this video and try to answer these questions on your own. Try to write down what you think the answer is or what these factors are that kind of determines each whatever variable is listed, because I'm about to give the answer. So the first part or the first question, starting over here, understanding how does exercise affect heart rate? This one's pretty obvious. We know that heart rate is increased with exercise. So heart rate increases with exercise. It's a linear, there's a linear relationship between exercise intensity and heart rate. The harder we exercise, like the faster we run, the more reps we do, the heavier we lift, whatever the example is, the harder we work, the higher our heart rate will be up until we reach maximal heart rate. So next question, why does heart rate increase? And what causes the heart rate, the increase in heart rate? So think about that question. Our answer, the reason heart rate increases is to meet the oxygen demand. So you think how does that allow oxygen demand to be met? If the heart rate increases, it means that the signal to activate each chamber is increased, meaning that the ventricles will pump more forcefully. With our increased heart rate, we're just pumping more blood per minute, allowing for more oxygen delivery. And then what causes that increase? This is where you have to kind of think outside of the box. Withdrawal of parasympathetic and increase in sympathetic activity. So sympathetic activity referring to central nervous system when we have increased sympathetic stimulation. It's also referring to the hormones such as epinephrine, norepinephrine, our adrenaline hormones that will increase our heart rate. Removal of parasympathetic, which would slow down. Next question, why does heart rate level off when the exercise intensity levels off? So if you thought about this question, the demand and supply of oxygen is equal. So let's think about this one. If intensity of our exercise is no longer increasing, but remains the same, our heart rate's probably gonna start to level off. What does that mean? It means we are in steady state. Think back to chapter 3. We talked about exercise intensity and how as we start exercising, our heart rate rapidly increases. Our body's trying to, and our breathing rate rapidly increases. We're trying to get enough oxygen for our body. But as our exercise intensity levels off and we reach this level of steady state, our heart rate levels off. Why is that? Because our oxygen demand is met. So we've met our oxygen demand, the intensity is no longer increasing. All right, same thing. We're gonna do this again. Oops. Okay, so doing this again. And again, pause the video, try to answer those questions on your own because we're about to go through each one of them. So first, what is the relationship between heart rate and exercise intensity? We've already answered this question here. There's a linear relationship, and it's a positive linear, meaning that, and this example down here shows treadmill speed. Basically, as I run harder, I'm running faster, my heart rate is going to start increasing all the way up until it reaches my maximum. So if I just keep running faster and faster and faster, my heart rate's gonna do the same thing. It's gonna increase until I hit my max. We already said that maximal heart rate is not influenced by training, it's influenced by age. So our age determines where that max heart rate will level off. So next question, how does exercise affect stroke volume? We probably already know this answer as well. So cardiac output, we know is a product of both heart rate and stroke volume. So if exercise increases our heart rate, we know that it's also gonna increase our stroke volume and then our cardiac output. So we said that cardiac output can reach up to 20 to 30 liters per minute from a rested state of 5 liters per minute, and that's blood pumped per minute. Which means if cardiac output increases, heart rate and stroke volume also increase. But look at this second part here. How does stroke volume increase? It does not increase the same way heart rate increases. Stroke volume increases up to 40 to 50% of our max. So instead of looking at this heart rate picture here where we see this linear increase, what you would see with stroke volume is you'd see it increase until about sub or sub-maximal intensity level, and then it'll start to level off. The further increase in heart rate up to our maximal is what increases cardiac output to its max. And then last, what causes stroke volume to increase? And we spent the last part of, or I guess the first part of part three, going over all of that. So what you do need to know for this chapter, a big part of this chapter was talking about stroke volume and all the factors that increase stroke volume. So we said over here, so starting with end diastolic volume. So first, what increases end diastolic volume? We said plasma volume. So plasma volume, we're about to get into in part four, the components of blood. But plasma volume expands with training. So we have the expansion of plasma volume, which increases total blood volume. That contributes to the EDV. Also, filling time and venous return. So venous return, that's the Frank-Starling mechanism. So venous return down here is just this increased blood flow back to the heart is going to stretch the ventricles, and it's going to allow greater filling time and a greater volume of filling. And then that's where that ventricular volume comes in. We just have a larger volume. So end diastolic volume is increased. And the preload, we said, was the stretching of those ventricular fibers. And then what happens? We have increased contractility. So the increased contractility comes from the ventricles stretching and then snapping back really quickly, increasing the force of contraction. And then last, we said, decreased total peripheral resistance or afterload. So this is basically the pressure that the heart has to overcome to pump blood to the entire body. So and we talked about resistance in the last video, that if there's a decreased resistance, there's an increase in flow. So decreased resistance, increase in stroke volume. So good, that was kind of our big review over each one of those variables. But let's kind of move on to something referred to as redistribution of blood flow. So what this picture shows is looking at blood flow to tissue during exercise and during rest. And it all has to do with how much oxygen the tissue needs at that time. So let's start down here with rest. So this is looking at our heart, and then it breaks down in percentages where the blood flow is going. So just looking at the bottom down here, we have cardiac output 5 liters per minute. So it's exactly what we learned earlier. That's average for everybody. So we see internal organs, 20 to 25%. We see the heart receives about 45%, kidneys 20, a bone, tiny proportion, brain about 15. But what we kind of want to look at, is our muscle. So 15 to 20% of our total cardiac output goes to our muscle at rest. Now look what happens with heavy exercise. So flip now your eyes to the top part of this. So with heavy exercise, now cardiac output has increased to 25 liters per minute. And we said that's kind of average 20 to 30 liters. But now look what happened. So we have a decrease in the percentage of that number going to our internal organs. But look where it all goes. It goes to our muscle because our muscle is working during the exercise. So now about 80 to 85% of our cardiac output is going to our muscles to deliver oxygen. So this is kind of the basics of blood flow redistribution. The next slide kind of shows the same thing, but just kind of in another picture. So here we have at rest again. So at a rested state, we have this nice distribution, and then this is measured in milliliters, but you move that decimal over and we have 5 liters for our cardiac output. So we see muscle receives about 20%, and then you can look at kind of all the other organs on what percent they receive. But then we move to exercise, and this shows 84% of our cardiac output is now going to our muscle. So it increased from 20 to 84, and we have a decrease in all these other variables here, or all these other organs and tissues. But if you notice, like the heart, So go over here. It still receives 4% of the cardiac output, but we see the milliliters of blood it's receiving is greater during exercise. But you have to think, this number's bigger as well. Even though the percent stayed the same, the heart still receives more than it did at rest. The skin also increased, so we have from 6% to, well, sorry, I meant 300 milliliters to 600 milliliters, but you see the percent actually decreases. What's interesting about blood flow to the skin is during light to moderate exercise, blood flow to the skin will increase. This will kind of help to sweat and kind of cool ourselves down. But during heavy, like maximal exercise, we have a decrease in blood flow to our skin because more of that blood is directed to the muscle. If you notice, next time you do like really intense exercise, you'll probably sweat more once you stop the exercise and the blood is able to flow back to your skin. And we have vasodilation at the skin. And then moving on, brain, same thing. We have a decreased percentage, but an increase in the amount. And then it kind of keeps going to our organs. But what I really care about you learning here is that from rest to exercise, we have an increase in cardiac output delivery from 20% to 80-84% going to the muscle now. These next few slides talk about how does this actually happen. It all depends on a balance between vasoconstriction and vasodilation, which I'm sure we already know those terms, but it has to do with the arterioles supplying the capillary bed and the precapillary sphincters. And so let's talk about that. So the word dilation means to increase, and it's talking about increasing the radius of the vessel. Constriction means to restrict or decrease the vessel radius. What are sphincters? So sphincters are these muscular rings here, and so you kind of see these rings that allow blood flow into the capillary bed. So here's the arteriole, which is a branch from an artery, and then we see as the blood flow branches extensively, it moves down here into our capillaries. So these are our sphincters. They allow blood flow into the capillary bed. There are muscular rings at the entrance of the capillary that can react to changes in the body by constricting or relaxing to allow blood flow into a certain area. So during rest, we'll have vasoconstriction to our muscles and then vasodilation to our organs, and that's controlled by those sphincters. During exercise, we'll have vasoconstriction to the organs and vasodilation to the muscles. So those sphincters react to intrinsic and extrinsic changes. So that's how they control the flow of blood into an area. It's based on the amount of intrinsic or extrinsic control and a nice balance between the two. So let's get into that. So extrinsic control. We already know how extrinsic control works. It's controlled from the central nervous system releasing hormones that will influence these vessels. So norepinephrine causes vasoconstriction, but epinephrine can actually cause both constriction and dilation. Norepinephrine is the primary neurotransmitter innervating these peripheral blood vessels, and they affect the receptors causing vasoconstriction, where epinephrine affects both types of receptors causing constriction and dilation. So it's kind of depends on a balance between the two. So extrinsic control is all due to the central nervous system, where intrinsic control is actually due to the vessel itself. So intrinsic control, autoregulation. Just like there was intrinsic control of the heart, that was called autorhythmicity. Autoregulation is blood flow regulation. And this has to do with changes in skeletal muscle during exercise, and it will stimulate chemoreceptors. We already know about chemoreceptors. They detect chemicals. So now the vessels are able to detect chemicals in the blood, and they kind of know when to dilate or when to constrict. So they can detect carbon dioxide, acidity like hydrogen ions, or partial pressure of oxygen. Autoregulation is just the intrinsic ability of an organ to maintain constant blood flow despite changes in pressure with exercise. So it's basically a sensory extension of the PNS, which is the peripheral nervous system, into blood vessels that detect changes in chemical concentrations. Like I said, CO2, hydrogen ions, or lactate. This triggers a reflexive action. So we look at this picture down here. We have amount of blood flow, and we have something at the bottom called perfusion pressure. Perfusion pressure is just the passage of blood through the circulatory system and the delivery of blood into a capillary bed. And we see dilation and we see constriction. Autoregulation is a good balance between the two. So at low perfusion pressures, we have dilation. At higher perfusion pressures, we have constriction. And that will determine total amount of blood flow into an area. All right, so that gets us to the end of part 3 and your study guide for quiz or chapter 6 quiz. So I know it looks like a lot. Go ahead and take a picture of this so you can study and make your study guide. But it'll be kind of everything from this part in the lecture back to the very start of chapter 6.